So it's definitely been a while since my last dark and moody food photography tutorial. And since then, I've got some new tricks up my sleeves and I wanted to share those with you here today so that you can make the most of your dark and moody food photography. What's shaking, bacon? I'm Joni Simon. Welcome to my studio. This is where I do food photography, and the goal here is to improve your food photography skills so you can feel confident behind the camera. And like I mentioned, today we are getting into the dark and moody vibes. I thought it was perfectly appropriate for the month of October to go this direction. I've got this veggie burger with a knife in it, kind of going for the killer burger look. But before we jump into the lighting tricks, I am excited to share that today's video is sponsored by the PPA, the Professional Photographers of America. I've been a member of the PPA for over 2 years now. I initially joined because along with your membership, you automatically get $15,000 worth of gear coverage, which we all know photography gear is expensive. And if this is your business, you want to make sure that stuff is insured. So that is an incredible perk that comes along with your membership. But they also have a ton of other great benefits, including data recovery services, which is absolutely vital, again, if you're working for clients. And then they also have customizable contract templates, which are super important for your proposals, model releases. I mean, tons of resources that any professional photographer is going to need in their business, in addition to tons of great education. And two, if you are a brand new member, if you sign up today via the link in the description box below, not only will you get a discount, but you also get a free pass, free access to their Imaging USA conference, both for 2021 as well as 2022. Now, their 2021 conference, this is the world's largest professional photographers conference. It's incredible. So many people participating, so many great educational resources, and the 2021 Imaging USA Right at Home is a virtual event, of course, happening January 17th through the 19th. And then their 2022 convention, which, fingers crossed, life will return back to normal and we can have in person. And so whether you are just starting out in your photography journey or you are working professionally, being a member of the PPA is a super valuable resource. So again, check out that link down the description box below, and thank you to the PPA for sponsoring this video. All right, so just to walk you through what we're working with here today, again, I was going for kind of like the October or something a little scary, thus the incorporation of the knife into that veggie burger. But I also thought like this would be kind of funny then to make it a veggie burger because, like, you know, no animals were harmed or killed in the process of making this burger. And so it's a beet veggie burger, and the recipe is actually from Caitlin from My Bowl, one of my favorite vegan YouTubers and bloggers. You can catch the recipe down below. It's super delicious, super easy to make. So thumbs up on that, Caitlin. But then I stacked it really nice and high. And there was definitely, like, I had to make this burger twice over just in order to get the height on it, because I wanted to make sure that the bun kind of butted up against the handle, because when I first made it, it just wasn't quite as tall enough. And it looked really sort of off balance with, like, so much of still, like, the steel part of the knife showing. So it was really important to get that height going on. But otherwise, a pretty simple setup. It's just veggie burger, knife on a plate, dark background, dark surface. The surface I'm shooting on here is a DIY backdrop. So if you've missed that video, you can check that one out. I've got a link down below. But now the all important lighting. And so whenever I am going for the dark and moody these days, my instant go-to, of course, I'm shooting strobes. That's what I'm shooting the majority of the time. I've got the Godox AD600 Pro, but you could absolutely do this with a speed light or any other flash-based lighting. What I'm using, my go-to in these sorts of situations, is gonna be a strip softbox with a grid so that I can really narrow and limit that spread of light. So this is a 12-inch by 36-inch strip softbox. I've got the grid on that. And again, what that's doing is it's taking all that light and just focusing it into that narrow beam. So we get sort of that effect of like a door being opened and the light is kind of streaming right through, or a window and we've just slightly opened the curtains. So we're just getting that little beam of light. And I thought what would be really fun and kind of play on then is the idea of a silhouette where we can see sort of illumination on the back of the subject, but that a lot of the front of the subject is in darkness. And so I thought that would really create an interesting sort of story, that silhouette effect. And so in order to get that silhouette effect, again, we want to make sure we're working with a modifier like a strip softbox with a really narrow, limited beam of light, and positioning that kind of on the back side of the subject. You know, we're we're used to sort of lighting subjects from the side or maybe some backlighting, but because we have such a limited spread of that light, kind of illuminates the back, so we get that little pop, that little glow. It reaches around just a little bit to the side, but otherwise the rest of it falls into shadow. And I really dug the silhouette, sort of like that brighter line along the handle of the knife. I thought that looked so cool. And just in terms of like creating some dimension and creating some drama, right? That we've got a lot of contrast going on. And that to me, whenever we've got a lot of contrast, like that sort of signifies higher emotions to me. So number one, we've got a modifier that's really limiting our spread of light. So then number two, then as I'm looking at this scene, I'm like, oh, but there's still a lot of like light pouring in, especially on the back of that plate. And I really wanted to like cinch in the light a little bit more. So that's where we bring in our second favorite thing, my second favorite trick that you've seen me use other times here on this channel, but just wanna reiterate the usage of this is using flags or gobos or something that we can use to block that light to further limit it. So I've just got a little bit of black foam core and an A-clamp, a small little A-clamp, and just placed that so that the light is still hitting on our subject, but that you can see it's now dead in the light that's hitting in the back of the scene. And that brighter light, because to me that brighter light that was falling on the lip of the plate was really kind of distracting. So adding that little block of light, that little flag right there, really helped to limit that light. And then also I was like, oh, there's just a little too much falling on the front. And so, you know, I could have brought out some more black foam core, but something that I'm notorious for doing is finding other dark colored things in the studio that are maybe smaller that can also limit the light. So in this case, I grabbed the roll of gaffer's tape. It was like the perfect size that I just wanted a little bit of extra shadow in the front, but I didn't want to, again, block the light from hitting the subject. So popped that little gaffer tape right there, had the nice little limitation of the light, and we were really on our way then to shaping that dark and moody look that I was going for. Then the third step in the process, after I've kind of positioned all this, I've taken the test shot and I'm looking at it, I'm like, I do still want just like a little kiss of light coming in on the front so that we can, you know, decipher that there are still layers there, sort of that sense of balance and rounding out the scene, but I don't want to add too much because again, I really want that silhouetted look. And so in that case, I thought, well, let's start off with adding a nice little kind of bump in the back. And so instead of just a plain old white card, one of my favorite things, and people like have been in the studio with me and they're like, what are you doing? So I've got this sparkly craft paper that you can get at your craft store. It's used for scrapbooking, it's covered in glitter. And yes, glitter is a mess and I understand. And it's a liability I'm willing to accept. But it's nice because you get just a little bit more punch in the reflection because it's a more reflective surface than just a plain old white card. And so positioning that more near the back gives me that nice little kind of kick on the back. It's not like a full kicker, like in terms of like a rim light or anything, but it's just a nice little like punch in the back so that I get that really nice separation of the burger from the background, even on that shadow side of the subject. And so again, I like where we're going with this, but I needed just one more little punch just to fill in to bring just a little bit of light into that shadowy area just to give a little bit of texture and interest. And so then I pulled in a white card. But the thing you gotta pay attention to with the white cards is that whole idea of the closer that the light source is, the more intense the light source is gonna be on your subject. And so in this case, pulling that white card pretty significantly far away from the subject so that we're still getting a little bit of balance, we're getting a little bit of fill light coming in there on that front side where it's really shadowy, just a little bit of fill light, but not a ton. And so that is definitely something, if you're playing with fill light, is moving that distance of that white card closer and further away, because it will really have an impact then on the intensity of that light hitting your subject. And so then once I felt like I got that really nice balance of the key light coming in from the back, creating that silhouette, got the nice little like limitation of the light due to those flags and cards, and then I've got the little kick kind of coming in from the back from that metallic paper, and then I've just got the little kiss of fill light here with the white, then I really felt like I got the shot I wanted. But all that being said, I'd done all that and I put all that together, and then I went back to that original shot where it was just like the basic limited light, and I kind of like that too. So it's not like you have to do your dark and moody food photography this way. There are tons of different options depending on the look that you're going for. But all that to say, I hope this inspires you for the next dark and moody shoot that you take on, that you've got some new tools in your tool belt. Thank you so much for stopping by. If you like this video, give it that thumbs up and be sure to subscribe if you're not already. And I hope you have a fantastic day. Hope you stay out of trouble. I will see you soon, okay? Bye. Ta-da! Burger on a stick. And of course the question is, how many sponges are in it? Makeup sponges. Any guesses? two. But I also had one underneath, kind of propping it up. So technically three.